皆様大変長らくお待たせいたしましてありがとうございます。私、セインズベリー日本芸術研究所の水鳥と申します。本日は皆様遠路からもいらしていただきまして大変感謝いたしております。本日は第3回目の石橋財団レクチャーシリーズということでございます。おととしからですね、石橋財団のご支援を得て、第1回目は東京大学福武ホール、第2回目は東京国立博物館で実施いたしまして、今年は初めての試みとして東京を出て京都に参りました。どうぞよろしくお願いいたします。まず私どものですね、研究所の理事をしておりまして、慶応大学名誉教授、千葉市立美術館の館長をしております、河合正友から一言ですね、皆様にご挨拶をさせていただきたいと思います。よろしくお願いいたします。
皆さんこんにちは。ご紹介ありましたセンジバリー日本、芸術研究所の、理事をしております河合と申します。外の天気はですね、大変明るくてですね、いいお天気なんですけど、ちょっと冷えるようで、皆さんちょっと体調崩された、老人も、私も老人なんですけども、老人もいらっしゃったようで、ちょっと始まりが遅れましたけども、そういうお寒い中ですね、たくさんの皆さんにおいでいただきまして、まず最初に御礼申し上げます。Sainsbury日本芸術研究所っていうのは、1999年にですね、ロバート・センズベリー、リサ・センズベリー、ロバート・センズベリー卿、その奥さんのリサさんの私的な寄付によってですね、成立した研究所でありまして、日本の芸術、美術、芸術、文化、その他一般のさまざまな日本の文化に関する研究をイギリスを拠点として、ロンドンから約2時間ぐらい離れた東の方に2時間ぐらい行ったところにノリッチっていう町があるんですけど、そこにイーストアンガリア大学という大学がありまして、そこに所属しながら独立性を持って研究活動、あるいはヨーロッパにおける研究支援活動をいたしております。で、そのヨーロッパだけではなく、そういう研究活動を日本にも反映し、お互いに刺激をし合うということの重要性がありまして、日本でのですね、活動を考えておりましたんですけど、なかなか、支援といいますか資金というものがございませんで、難渋しておりましたところ、石橋財団さんがですね、ご支援いただきまして、そして石橋財団のレクチャーとしてですね、今水鳥総括所長がですね、お話したように、今から3年前ですか、今回で3回ですから、東京大学で1度、それから東京国立博物館を会場にして昨年、そして、今回はですね、幸いにですね、京都造形技術大学の、失礼します、日本庭園歴史遺産研究センターのご協力、ご協賛を賜りまして、京都でですね、そのこういう、研究発表会、あるいは研究集会を持てたことは大変幸いでありまして、私ども研究所としては、京都造形大学さん、そして石橋財団に改めてお礼を申し上げたいと思います。 まあ、京都はですね、私が申し上げるまでもなくですね、日本庭園の発祥の地であり、かつですね、明治期にはですね、この東山あたりにですね、上地さん、上地さんって言ってるんですけど、小川治兵衛、有名な小川治兵衛が活躍した場所でありまして、そして、この造形技術大学ではその造園家としても、あるいは造園研究家としてもですね、日本を代表する方としての天ヶ崎先生がこの研究所の所長さんをされていて、今日研究発表していただけます渡辺俊夫先生、それから、失礼ちょっとすいません、ね、僕カタカナが覚えられなくて、ウイベカウテル先生が、こちらの客員教授でもいらっしゃるし、それからソウルの国立大学の、庭園に関する学科の教授をされているカウテル先生においでいただきましてですね、カウトル先生については日本庭園と自然美というお話、それから渡辺先生に関してはそこにタイトルがありますけれども、西洋社会は日本庭園をどのように関わってきたかという、まあ、一種の日本文化のヨーロッパにおける需要と、あるいは相互の影響関係というようなことがですね、おそらくお二人の発表の中で、議論されていくことと思います。お集まりの皆さんもこういうこの、テーマに大変興味を持ってお祭り回りいただいたので、お話を受けたまりながら、あるいは時間があればディスカッションをしていただいて、一日ですね、非常に充実した会議になることを願ってはいません。改めて、再度お礼の言葉を申し上げますけれども、ご支援いただいた石橋財団の方、そして、京都造形大学が、のご協賛いただいた京都造形大学に改めてお礼を申し上げて、簡単ですけど私のご挨拶させています。ありがとうございます。
ありがとうございました。それでは今河合からもご紹介いただきましたように、一人目の講演は渡辺先生にお願いしたいと思います。一言流れをご説明いたします。本日はお二人の講演者の先生からの講演を続いて行った後、15分の小休憩を挟みまして、第2部はご協賛いただいている日本庭園歴史遺産研究センターの天崎所長様の司会進行によりまして、お二人の講演者の方とのパネルディスカッション、その間には会場の皆様からのご質問もぜひお受けしたいと思いますので、よろしくお願いいたします。またお手元の資料の中にアンケートの紙が一つございます。ぜひ、お帰りになる前にですね、忌憚のないご意見をそこに記入いただきまして、我々の参考にさせていただければと思います。ありがとうございます。それでは渡辺先生、よろしくお願いいたします。
聞こえますか？はい。では始めます。で、英語で喋ります。It is lovely to be here in Kyoto, the Mecca of Japanese gardens, and it is an honor for me to be able to give this talk here today at the Kyoto University of the Arts, Arts and Design, the Mecca of Garden Design History in Japan.The Ishibashi Foundation Lecture Series explores how Japan and Europe inspired each other in the field of art from the 19th century to the present day. In today's talk, I should like to look into how the West interacted with Japanese gardens from about the mid-19th century to the present day. This is, of course, a vast topic, and I should like to focus on four themes for which I have done some work myself. First, how did many Westerners encounter Japanese gardens for the first time in Edo, Tokyo, and also at the numerous international exhibitions across the world? Second, how was the information on Japanese gardens conveyed to the West in English language publications? Third, how was a new canon of Japanese gardens created during the first half of the 20th century through a complex interactions between the Japanese and the Westerners? And finally, I should like to discuss some telling examples of Japanese gardens created in the West. I always wanted to study cultural interactions between Japan and other countries, as I grew up in a transnational environment. My father is a Japanese and my mother a German. I was born in Switzerland, grew up in Japan, and studied in Tokyo, Basel, and London. I came to the study of the history of Japanese gardens relatively late. My PhD, completed in 1984, was on High Victorian Japanism. And since then, I have explored the artistic relationship between Britain and Japan. The PhD thesis dealt with the period between 1850 and 1870. And I tried to read everything published in English on Japan between 1850 and 1870. And of course, that was not possible. But this exercise led me to read an awful lot of travelogues on Japan. This led me to my first rather surprising discovery about Japanese gardens in its capital, Edo, named Tokyo after the 1868 Meiji Restoration. It seems that the overwhelming impression the foreign visitor got from this city was how green it was. For us who know present-day Tokyo, this is an unexpected reaction. However, if we look at a map of Edo, a great part of it was simply gardens. Edo was an artificially created capital, almost like Brasilia. Every daimyo, the head of domain, had to keep at least three residences in Edo. And there were nearly 300 of them. Shirahata Yozaburo, in his classic book, Daimyo Teien, Daimyo Gardens, published in 1997, estimated that just before the 1868 Meiji Restoration, there were around 1,000 daimyo gardens and probably many thousands of large and small gardens within the city limits. Particularly around the Edo Castle, the place was tightly packed with such feudal residences with big gardens. The British diplomat Rutherford Alcock mentioned how Edo was dominated by low buildings and trees. The first British legation was set up at Tōzenji at Takanawa Heights, and he praised the wonderful view from there, as you see here in this illustration. Alcock was not unique. More or less all visitors to Japan in mid-19th century praised gardens in Japan, even those in remote places such as Hakodate. While these reports were reaching the West, in 1873, the first major official Japanese garden was built in Vienna at the ground of the Weltausstellung. This was the first international exhibition in which the Meiji government participated and was also the first time a Japanese garden was given a proper exposure in Europe. The garden gave spectators the first impression of what Japan was like. In fact, the construction of the garden and the building was delayed. The Japanese gardeners and builders were still working when the exhibition was opened. This setback actually provided an unexpected spectacle for the visitors and was commented on favorably. Just a few days after the opening on May the 5th, the Japanese officials managed to arrange a visit to the Japanese pavilion by the Emperor Franz Joseph himself, along with Empress Elizabeth, as shown in an illustration published in a German periodical. The Empress, renowned for her beauty, provides the central focal point of the composition, whereas the humble Japanese gardeners are admiring her, bowing to her in an almost Edward Muybridge-like slow motion sequence. From this time onwards, a Japanese garden, even a small-scale one, became a regular contribution by the Japanese to major international exhibitions. For the period between the 1860s and 1960s, Japanese gardens were on view at these major crowd-attracting events more or less every few years. Each of these gardens offered a highly visible space imbued with Oriental exoticism with a Western public sight. The total number of people who visited these Japanese gardens must have been extremely high, as even a single international exhibition routinely reached attendance numbers of many millions. It is also important that these gardens were accessible to everybody from all classes. These Japanese gardens played a significant role in the construction of the image in the larger world of Japan and Japanese culture. A number of Japanese gardens also enjoyed lives beyond the exhibition themselves, though they usually went through a number of changes, sometimes to a degree that only a rudiment of their previous design remained. For example, the Viennese 1873 Japanese garden, including its Shinto shrine, was actually sold to the Alexandra Park Company and was moved to London. The writer and designer Christopher Dresser, who traveled to Japan a few years later in 1876-77 and wrote a major book on Japanese art and crafts, played a key role in this transaction. In this illustration, we can clearly identify the same features buildings which, alas, has not survived. These gardens were clearly meant as means for promoting Japanese culture at these international events, but the intention and actual effect did not always match. Kendall Brown, in his perceptive book, Japanese Style Gardens of the Pacific West Coast, provides details on a number of these cases. For example, the 1904 Louisiana Purchase Exposition in St. Louis coincided with the Russo-Japanese War, and the Japanese pursued quite an aggressive policy, attempting to take over the space at the exhibition vacated by the withdrawal of the Russians. However, such a move also necessitated conserving funds so that instead of replica of Nagoya Castle, a more peaceful stroll garden with temple-style wooden buildings was constructed, which elicited the desired effect. Next. Compared to this, the 1915 Panama Pacific International Exposition in San Francisco created a quite complicated situation. Initially, when the Japanese withdrew their participation because of the introduction of California of the Alien Land Act, banning Japanese from land ownership, efforts were made to bring the Japanese back by postponing the vote on the bill until after the fair was concluded. In the end, the Japanese did participate, but in this debate, the tea garden assumed a symbolic role representing the whole issue of Japanese participation. Quotes such as, I quote, "We cannot sell our birthright for a tea garden," or "It, labor, will not be lured from its opposition by promise of the most beautiful tea garden that the mind of Oriental man has conceived," end of quote. These show that whatever the political situation, there was a general agreed perception that a Japanese garden was something very beautiful and of great value. Apparently, the debate was over whether this aesthetic value was greater than the basic rights of the workers. Despite the hostility of many Californians towards Japanese immigrants, most visitors were charmed by the so-called fairy garden. There were examples of a more blatantly propagandist efforts by the Japanese during the 1930s to ameliorate the bad impression Japan was gaining through its aggressive China policy. Now, a rather briefer second part of my talk. Let us now examine how the Japanese garden was introduced to the West through publications. A key text for the understanding and appreciation of Japanese gardens by those in the West is Josiah Kondo's Landscape Gardening in Japan, published in Tokyo in 1893, including a supplement which contained many colotype photographs. It is regarded even now as a classic of its kind in the West. One of the motives for Kondo to publish this book was to make clear his recommendation that European and American readers consider designing a Japanese garden. His arguments in persuading Western readers to adopt the design of a Japanese garden are based on purely aesthetic considerations. In creating a Japanese garden in the West, he underplays the historical and culturally specific elements of a Japanese garden design, emphasizing rather a more abstract and formalist notion of beauty, such as composition, etc. Thus, Kondo's book could be regarded as one of the final products of the Japonism of the aesthetic movement. I should like to mention that in the supplement, the illustration volume, the gardens in Tokyo occupy three quarters of the photographs, and gardens from Aomori, Niigata, and Kagoshima are included. However, there are only six from Kyoto, and Ginkakuji has two. This means only five examples from Kyoto are included, and most astonishingly, none of either Katsura or Ryoanji. Why this is so will be made clearer in the next section of my talk. It is important to note that Kondo did his homework in writing this book and cites a comprehensive list of Japanese books he consulted. His views expressed in this book very much reflect the Japanese orthodoxy at the end of the 19th century. Kondo's purely aesthetic view expressing late 19th century ideas about Japan radically changed with another classic of its kind. Harada Jiro's The Gardens of Japan, published by the studio in London in 1928. Harada emphasized the Japanese garden as, I quote, "a necessity in life, not so much for the physical as for the mental and spiritual." By the 1920s, clearly, spirituality assumed a central role in defining the meaning of a Japanese garden, whereas Konda, in his earlier publication, did not refer to such matters at all. During the 1930s, another new appreciation of Japanese gardens emerges. Christopher Tannard's book, Gardens in the Modern Landscape, published in London in 1938, is strictly speaking not even a book on Japanese gardens. His argument concerned the way in which one should build an authentic modern garden. In this context, Tannard hails the Japanese garden as an important source for inspiration for all modern garden designers. He provides a sensitive and at times detailed analysis of the Japanese garden and its usefulness. Fascinatingly, one of the examples he illustrates is a modernist garden by Horiguchi Steny, thus showing that Western interest in modern Japanese culture is not confined to post-1960s period. These books introduced Japanese gardens to Western readers with their texts and illustrations. In a way, these were one-way traffic affecting just the Western audience. However, during the early 20th century, the situation gets quite a lot more complicated when Westerners started to intervene actively in the appreciation of certain types of Japanese gardens in general, as this was a period when the canon of Japanese gardens was radically rewritten both by the Japanese and the Westerners. This is now my third section. When Shirahata published his book Daimyo Tein in 1997, his stance was to challenge the Zen orthodoxy of the denigration of Edo period Daimyo gardens. He quotes Mori Osamu, who criticized gardens created from the mid-Edo period onwards as losing artistry, lowering the quality of the gardeners, and becoming degenerate. Shirahata's great contribution was the rehabilitation of the Edo period daimyo gardens and in trying to find the source of why they lost their standing so much. He identified two villains. Sorry about that. One was Mori Osamu and the other Shigemori Mire. They were both giants in the historiography of Japanese gardens. Their meticulous documentation, historical research, and analysis of Japanese historical gardens were detailed and voluminous. Their authoritative publications basically defined the field. Mori's idea was the philosophy expressed in the famous 11th century manual Sakuteki, Records of Garden Making, and for him, the supreme expression of this was realized in the Katsura Detached Palace Garden of early Edo period. On the other hand, Shigemori regarded the dry stone garden style developed during the 14th century, mainly in Zen temples, as the epitome of Japanese garden art. According to Shirahata, these two apparently did not communicate much with each other and held on to different ideologies of garden design, but what they had in common was their low estimation of mid to late Edo period gardens. Because Mori and Shigemori were such dominating personalities in the field, their views became so influential and created new orthodoxy from which we are getting somewhat freer only very recently. Indeed, Shirahata's book itself is evidence of this new trend. Likewise, the gardens at Katsura and Ryuanji have recently inspired more skeptical appraisals as well. Pertinently, Shirahata also argues that the two garden design ideals of court and Zen aesthetics promulgated by Mori and Shigemori were really a modern creation, as what they argued is focus too much on the visuality of the garden design, very much a concern of modernity. Okay, let us examine two such cases where the role of Westerners happened to be crucial. First, the case of the promotion of Katsura Detached Palace. In 1986, Inoue Shoichi exposed how this was done in his groundbreaking and iconoclastic book, Tsukurareta Katsura Rikyu Shinwa, The Manufactured Myth of Katsura Detached Palace. Up to this time, the general consensus was that it was the German architect, designer, and writer, Bruno Taut, who rediscovered the beauty of Katsura. However, Inoue disassembles this myth comprehensively. He established that there were differences of opinion regarding past architecture between the older and newer generations of Japanese architects. Meiji generation architects such as Itō Chūta were not appreciative of Katsura, whereas the younger generation architects with modernist ambitions promoted it. Particularly important was the book Kako no Kōsei, Constructions of the Past, published by Kishida Hideto in 1929. This was a compilation of photographs of old Japanese architecture, and Kishida declares that his intention was to examine past architecture with contemporary sensibilities to try to find the ideal of the modern in these older Japanese structures. Kishida promotes Japanese architecture from the past, such as Katsura or Ise Shrine, in purely visual terms, devoid of historical or religious connotations. This attitude strongly reflects the Western tradition from the art for art's sake of the aesthetic movement to the formalist doctrine of modernism. Inoue's detailed analysis makes it clear that this new perception was shared by many modernist architects such as Horiguchi Stemi, Tange Kenzo, and others, and soon became the orthodoxy. Inoue proves that all this had already happened before Taut's visit to Japan. In fact, Taut's visit was made at the invitation of Nihon International Kenchiku Kai, International Architectural Association of Japan, a modernist group. It was Ueno Isaburo who, together with like-minded friends, seemed to have masterminded the schedule of Taut's visit and coaxed him to praise Katsura. Once Taut's praise was uttered, it became orthodoxy. So in our context, Taut's role was less of a direct and independent intervention, but more of a proselytizer of an idea already extant within Japan. Quite similar to Josiah Konda expressing the then current Japanese view being a mouthpiece of the Japanese, whether intended or unintended. Nevertheless, Taut's publications in German and in Japanese had a huge impact on how people perceived the gardens of Katsura Detached Palace and assisted to make Katsura a canonical garden. Exactly the same pattern also happens with our second case, Ryōan-ji Garden. In 2009, Yamada Shoji wrote a detailed account of the reception of Ryōan-ji Garden in his meticulously researched book, Shots in the Dark, Japan, Zen, and the West, published by the University of Chicago Press, which is a revised edition of his original Japanese edition entitled Zen Toyu Nano Nihonmaru, the Japan ship named Zen, published in 2005. Yamada chronicled Taut's encounter with Ryōan-ji Garden. Ueno Isaburo and also Kurata Chikatada, two modernist architects, took Taut to Ryōan-ji on 3rd of October 1933. However, according to Kurata, Pout's reaction to Ryoanji Garden was quite different from that of Katsura, as he said nothing. He said nothing while at the garden, and only on the way back uttered that it was very strange, femde, for a foreigner. Nevertheless, Taut wrote admiringly about Ryoanji in his publications, and he plays an important role within the history of the canonization of Ryoanji Garden. The person who was instrumental in making Ryoanji as the embodiment of Zen and the pinnacle of the art of garden design in Japan was the Hawaiian-born, the Hawaii-based American writer and garden designer, Lorraine E. Cook. During the 1930s, she emerged as a new champion of the Japanese garden, and in particular of Ryoanji Garden, publishing a series of books on Japanese gardens. Her 1935 book, 100 Kyoto Gardens, published in London and Kobe, has two black and white photos of Katsura, but boasts a rare early color plate and a black and white one of Ryoanji. Indeed, Yamada states that it was Kak who, for the first time, identified Ryoanji Garden as a Zen garden in this book, as an esoteric Zen temple garden, and that the creator of this garden was a follower of Zen. Yamada gives the date as 1936, but there is an earlier edition from 1935, which would strengthen Kak's claim to be the first foreigner to say that the Ryoanji Garden is Zen. Yamada refers to Wiebe Kautz, our second speaker today, his research, which established that this notion of Ryoanji Garden as a representative garden of Zen Buddhism is only recent and probably originated in the 1934 publication, Essays in Zen Buddhism by the famous proselyte of Zen in the West, Daisetsu Suzuki. In this context, Lorraine Cook was very early in arguing the Zenness of Ryoanji already in 1935. And Yamada suspects that this came not from Mire Shigemori, but from Daisetsu Suzuki, to whom Kak was also close. In fact, they were neighbors when she was staying in Kyoto between 1932 and 1935. And also Suzuki's wife, Beatrice Lane, was an American. In her 1940 book, The Art of Japanese Gardens, published in New York, the remit was widened from just covering Kyoto to the whole of Japan, but still the number of plates on Ryoanji increases to 3. In her 1957 catalog of an exhibition of photographs of Japanese garden at the University of Oregon at Eugene, one of the only 3 illustrations is of Ryoanji. In her final and probably her most popular book, The World of the Japanese Garden, published by John Weatherhill in 1968, there are 6 illustrations of Ryoanji, including one in snow and a rather illogical one taken from the back of 2 rocks not normally visible. Here, the top photo. She also illustrated the garden of Takai-an in Kyoto, the one below here. This is illustrated here, but for the sole purpose of claiming the success of Ryoanji Garden at the expense of, in her view, the poorly designed Takai-an garden. Once Ryoanji Garden was discursively and visually connected with the idea of Zen, the linkage is promoted more and more frequently. As Yamada points out, Kak, in her 1940 book, The Art of Japanese Garden, devotes an entire chapter entitled Sermon in Stone on Ryoanji Garden and gushes as follows, I quote, "Undoubtedly, this garden is one of the world's greatest masterpieces of religiously inspired art," end of quote. In her subsequent publications, she continues to make this point. This view had a significant impact on understanding of Ryōanji because her writings, particularly her 1968 book, The World of the Japanese Garden, were among the most popular books on this subject published in English at the time and thus very influential. Even more significant than the cut in proselytizing the Ryōanji Garden was the artist Isamu Noguchi, here with Shigemori Mire. For Yamada, Noguchi was the person most responsible for publicizing the rock garden overseas. Noguchi was a truly transnational figure. He was born in Los Angeles, and his mother was an American, and his father was the Japanese poet and writer Noguchi Yonejiro, normally known as Yone Noguchi in the West. Yone was an important figure in the story of East-West relations interaction in his own right, but then he abandoned both mother and child. Isamu and his mother came to Japan when he was three, but Isamu then left for the USA alone when he was only 13. His identity is essentially that of a Japanese American. However, he visited Japan many times and identified himself strongly with the art of Japanese Zen garden design, in particular with Ryōanji Garden. Yamada details Noguchi's sojourn in Japan in 1950, in particular, and refers to Dora Ashton's monograph on Noguchi, where she writes that in preparation for this trip, Noguchi read and reread Suzuki's book Zen and Japanese Culture, and books by Bruno Taut. We see a clear pattern emerging of the appreciation of Ryōanji Garden and Zen culture spreading and overlapping. Yamada refers to a revealing episode. When Noguchi visited Ryōanji for the first time in 1931, apparently he was not particularly moved by the garden. However, in 1950, his preparatory readings of Suzuki and Taut put him into a better position to appreciate the site. Also, Yamada speculates whether Noguchi read Kak's 1940 The Art of Japanese Garden with its eulogy of Ryōanji Garden. Then, between 1961 and 64, Noguchi created the commission for his sunken garden at Chase Manhattan Plaza in New York, which he called My Ryōanji, as it were. Here we see the impact of Ryōanji traveling across the world to New York as an artistic reinterpretation. As we can see, this emergence of Katsura and Ryōanji as the twin pinnacles of Japanese garden design is of such recent origin, not going back beyond the 1930s. Also here, the Western protagonists played varied, complicated, and major roles in creating this canon. Okay, now the fourth and last part of my story, and this is Japanese gardens created in the West. We have already seen some examples created at the international exhibitions, but the three peaks of such interest were during the first decade of the 20th century, the immediate decades after World War II, and from about the 1990s up to now. Indeed, Japanese gardens were created in these countries on a more or less continuous basis. In that regard, it can be said that the Japanese garden was probably one of the most significant phenomena of 20th and indeed 21st century Japanism. I have seen many Japanese gardens outside Japan. In fact, I visited Japanese gardens in all the continents except Antarctica, which I assume doesn't have any. To show how varied such a garden could be, I wanted to show you just two examples from North America and multiple examples from one region, that of Eastern Europe. My first example is Queen Liliuokalani Garden at Hilo, which is a town on the Big Island in Hawaii. That's Hilo. And this is the garden. And this is the old town. This garden has so far evaded detailed scholarly attention, and it is exciting as an art historian to be the first chronicler. This garden is situated at the sea with a view of Mount Mauna Kea. Beyond the bay. A startling similarity to Sengan-en in Kagoshima, Japan, with Sakurajima volcano used as a borrowed landscape. Yeah. It is by far the most important tourist attraction of the town, and when I was there, many people visited the site any time during the day. By 1924, the population of Nikkei, Japanese, reached 42% of the total population of Hawaii. This has eased since, but before and during the war, the garden was situated close to where a large number of Japanese Americans lived. The tourist brochures indicate that the Queen donated the space in honor of the hard-working Japanese immigrants. But I could not find any such evidence from my search at the local library, nor in the file of the County Parks and Recreation Department based at Hilo. The space seemed to have belonged to the local authority already before it was decided to create a Japanese garden here. It was inaugurated in 1917, and the name of the Queen was given to the park because the Queen died in that year, and it was named in honor of her, named to honor her. Queen Liliuokalani was the last queen of Hawaii and was by all accounts loved by the population. The idea of the Japanese garden was initiated by the wife of a local businessman who was inspired by the Kinkakuji Temple in Kyoto when they traveled to Japan in 1914. This soon became a public project and became under the control of the county of Hawaii. Information on the early period of the park is sparse, but the first designer of the park was a Mr. Yamamoto, a local contractor, possibly the man here in the photo. You can also see how the tree has grown meantime. This garden was hit twice by tsunami, and on both occasions were badly damaged. Going through the records, one is struck by its constant changes and additions. The key issue with this garden is a multiplicity of identity, which is associated with this garden, that of Hawaii, USA, Japanese American, and even that of Kenjinkai, local associations of Japanese prefectures, evidenced by the glut of stone lanterns donated by many of them. My second example here in this section is the gardens of Manzanar internment camp in California. After the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor on 7th of December 1941, President Franklin D. Roosevelt authorized the relocation of internment of about 120,000 Japanese Americans. The Manzanar internment camp was the first of a number of war relocation centers set up away from the Pacific coast. Manzanar. It was hastily built in Owens Valley, at the foot of the Sierra Nevada mountains range. The whole site covered about 6,000 acres with about 550 acres used for housing. By June 1942, There were nearly 10,000 Japanese Americans housed there. With the end of the war, all internees left the site. When I visited the site, what struck me was the astonishing beauty of the place. The snow-capped Sierra Nevada mountains range dominated the scenery, and there was an eerie silence at this near desert place. The barracks were then cleared, and only very few structures remains now. The history of Manzanar contains much suffering of the Japanese Americans, who had to leave their homes at a very short notice with luggage only, the luggage only they themselves could carry, and no pets. The novels such as David Guterson's 1994 Snow Falling on Cedars or Julie Otsuka's 2002 When the Emperor Was Divine tell us poignantly how great these sufferings were. However, the gardens of Manzanar tell another side of this story. More than a dozen gardens at this site have been identified, and at the time, even competitions were held. What distinguishes Manzanar Gardens from most other internment camp gardens is that most seem to have been created by professionals. Among the internees, there were about 400 who were engaged in garden and gardening-related professions. The garden service industry in Los Angeles was apparently more or less a monopoly by the Japanese Americans. This meant that many of the Japanese garden designers at Manzanar had expertise in garden design, and this shows. They were allowed to go into the Sierra Nevada mountain range in search of suitable rocks with a military escort. Some of the excavated sites show a range of different rocks, such as granite, not available on site. Elaborate water structures were also built. Both the creators and the consumers of the gardens were mainly Japanese Americans. These Japanese gardens existed only during the war period and are testament to the resilience of human spirit, and also how the art of garden design could create a space for comfort, contemplation, and solace under difficult conditions. Now, my final case is not from just one country, but from a whole region, and that of Eastern Europe. I have already mentioned that from about the last decade of the last century up to our own time is one of the three peaks of Japanese gardens outside Japan. It might turn out as the greatest period of them all. The sheer number of Japanese gardens created worldwide is phenomenal. The Japanese Garden Society in Britain lists around 150 within Britain. North America probably has at least double that amount. Another area which needs urgent investigation is actually Japanese gardens built in Asia, but that's for another day. However, let us briefly examine Japanese gardens in Eastern Europe. When I organized a workshop on transnational Japanese gardens at SISJAC, the Sainsbury Institute in Norwich, about a year and a half ago, Wiebe was there too, I asked Dr. Piotr Spassky, who did his PhD on Polish Japanism with me, whether he could join us. He said, oh, should I do one on Japanese gardens in Poland? And I said, no, can you just check how many Japanese gardens are there in Eastern Europe? Within 2 weeks, he found an astonishing over 100 examples from Eastern Europe, including countries from Balkans and Turkey. He said most of them were created within the last 10 to 20 years. Many of them were given as present as part of sister city arrangement, others based on private and public initiatives. The reasons are varied, but the sheer quantity overwhelms. I should like to show you a small selection from Piotr's slides in a rough chronological order. This will be a 1 minute presentation. And the point of this 1 minute presentation is just to give you the feel of their quantity and diversity. Okay? Ready? Go. Belarus, Hungary, Poland, Slovenia and Ukraine, Bulgaria, Turkey, Romania, Slovakia, Russia, Serbia, Macedonia, Lithuania, Czech Republic, Azerbaijan, Estonia, Croatia. There you are. This is a map Piotr created, and he's still adding to it regularly. In conclusion, what story does a Japanese garden tell? Those are my last slides. I wanted to just show you two examples from the southern hemisphere. The initial question was how the West interacted with Japanese gardens. It has become clear that there isn't just one way this interaction happens. It occurs in so many varied and fascinating ways. I come back to the question of authenticity. Most Japanese gardens outside Japan claim in their brochure that they are authentically Japanese. In fact, most of them are not. But still, most of them convey something about Japan, some wonder, be it beauty, be it calmness. And I often compare Japanese gardens with Japanese cuisine. Really authentic ones, whether served in restaurants in Kyoto or London, are wonderful. But many others use Japanese ingredients, cooking techniques, taste combinations, and aesthetics to create something original and worthwhile. Japan becomes a catalyst for creativity. The same thing happens with gardens. A Japanese garden in Johannesburg uses bright red local stones, as you see here, and highly exotic birds fly around. Another beautiful garden in Kaura, Australia, incorporates many large eucalyptus trees, as you see here at the back. Neither could happen in Japan, but both are touched by Japan and are wonderful places just to be there. As a proof of a good meal is the wonder one experiences by eating it, isn't the proof of a good garden the wonder one experiences just by visiting it? Thank you very much.